For many years, you couldn't get Kerry people to attend semi-finals. Last weekend, you couldn't get them to stay. Amidst the rubble, Breaking Ball places the following tributes. Just before half-time, this goal sank a floundering Kerry. And so John McDermott retired the champions, more successfully than he had retired himself earlier this year.
An absolute cracker of a goal. Beautiful piece of interplay between Graham Geraghty initially, Ollie Murphy to, I think, Graham Geraghty into the onrushing McDermott, and side-footed the ball into the corner of the net.
Ask the Kerry supporters, was it the 15-point margin? The lack of response? No, it was the Matador sound effects. Ay, caramba.
They're looking for another goal in towards Geraghty. Eamon Fitzmaurice has it.
Was there any consolation for Kerry? Surely the minor match against Dublin? No, next year maybe. As befits a man with a fast food franchise, Greg Kennedy had inter-county success served up quickly. But after those underage medals, he's starving again.
Well, I think the fact that we were written off really fired us up, and I think the amount of effort we put in all year merited a good performance like that.
And it's already getting physical in midfield. McAvoy there and Richie Murray even before the ball is thrown in.
Down to every last player the last day, we tore into them and it paid off in the end, you know. I've been there for the last number of years, and I think this year has been the toughest year for training, and I think the team are fitter now than they ever were. I think we just added an extra dimension to our fitness and our mental attitude this year that we hadn't got in previous years.
Rough and tumble stuff happening. Liam Dunn is involved on Brian O'Mara.
It's becoming soccer orientated, the way the yellow cards have been flashed around. You know, Brian O'Mara and Liam Dunn, you know, I think it was ridiculous that they got sent off, because like that goes on in games, and you know, it goes on in every corner of the field. There was a good few heavy tackles in the Kilkenny game, you know, but at the end of the day, it's a men's game, and if a lad warps a hurl across me, I don't mind that, you know, like, because he might get one warped across him. Well, I'd probably have to hold my hand up. It's a cornerback's job to stop the forward and try and upset him as much as possible. I annoyed Henry for a while, and we both got yellow cards. I remember Liam Hodgins losing the ball, going out, and DJ got it, and I said, if he passes me out, there may be a goal on, and if he does... So I was just going 110% I was going for DJ, but I wasn't going with him with any intent or anything like that, so... It was just unfortunate that he slipped, and I kind of caught him on the head rather than on the chest. I thought you'd listen. Well, I wouldn't like to say on television what my immediate reaction was, which was fairly bad, you know. But kind of upset, disappointed for family and disappointed for friends and people that were wishing me well, and at the same time hoping that the guys would lift their game and get on with it, you know. Because it's going to happen in games where players have been sent off, and you have to adjust to the situation.
Gregory Kennedy is gone, 28 and a half minutes into the first half.
If it was late on the second half, it mightn't be so bad, but when we hadn't reached half time, it was a bit of a signal, you know.
Somehow. Kilman trying to get inside. JJ Delaney, it's Kilman! He's kicking!
You know, the guys adapted themselves well, and hopefully that we don't get anybody sent off the next day, you know, because it is a big blow to a team. It's hard enough with 15, not to mind 14, so from that perspective, you'd like everybody to stay in the field, you know? I was just looking back there the other night, and there's, I think, 6 of the 94 minor team, and I think 10 of the 96 under-21 team, and the current team, and there's probably 5 or 6 more on the panel. So from that point of view, we've known each other a while, and we get on well together. There's no animosity in the Galway set-up whatsoever, and we're there for one reason, is to try and win All-Ireland.
Kennedy again.
I think the highlight of my career, it would be, first of all, making the Galway senior team in 98, and again coming back this year after a two-year absence, and getting on to the first 15 again. When we won the minor, I suppose we were young, innocent. We didn't really appreciate it at the time, and maybe in a few years it probably will be the highlight of my career.
The Log of Dia, the Law of Gregory.
99, the disagreement with management, and I stand by my disagreement. I came back this year and I said I'd give it 100% and see how it went, and it's going okay so far, you know. But as Noel Lane said at the start of the year, he will be judged this year only if he wins in All-Ireland. Anything else but in All-Ireland will be a failure.
Two Martin Colemans, one jersey. The Cork goalkeeping gene is successfully transmitted.
I was a bit too young. I think I've seen him play once, but I've vague memory of it. Like, but all I hear is the stories of like him and all his brothers playing like during the 70s.
And this is John Quigley. He's on the 21-yard line. He's trying to get through. He takes a shot. A great save by Martin Coleman.
I saw the tapes of the games in Cork Park and stuff like that, but I don't actually remember him playing personally. You know.
I appeared in 3 senior finals. We won 76, 77 and 78. 77 would always stick out in my mind. That's a save I brought off from my great friend in Wexford, Christy Keogh. The last 3 minutes, we were up 3 pints.
In a goes to Christy Keogh, a shot and a great save by Martin Coleman. Oh, what a great...
I lost my lenses about 12 minutes to go. I got a belt in the side of the head and I caught one before I fell on the ground and I put it into my mouth. And I cleared the ball and I put it back into my eye then, which wasn't the best vision in the world, but I had 60% vision for the last 10 minutes, which was enough to see me through to the final whistle.
Martin Coleman, what the puck out?
I'd like to have his puck out anyway, because like, that was obviously his strongest point, like, and well, obviously winning 3 All-Ireland medals in a row, like, I'd like to do that as well someday.
He's keeping up a family tradition, and since he was about 2 years of age, all he wanted was playing goal. So I told him the best of luck to him, and someday he might play in Cork Park. And the one thing about this final, Sean O'Leary, a great friend of mine, in the training around the 70s, his son is captain. And there was a sub to me, Mickey O'Connor, he was a sub goalie, and his son is also, he's playing full back. It would be nice to see 3 players that played 25 years ago, and their 3 sons will be playing the minor final.
Martin Coleman's got the book. Perfect post, and didn't see offer. Went to Stafford, Kevin Hart, the chance to get Kevin.
The Kilkenny game was a tough game. We started off slow again, like, it took us a quarter of an hour to score in that game, and we came at him right towards the end of the first half, and it was 7-5 at halftime. And when we came out in the second half then, Kieran Murphy from Sarsfield scored a great goal, which was 1 of 3 he got for the day, like, and that kind of set us on the way. But Kilkenny came back at us with about, I suppose, 10 minutes to go and scored a goal on the points to draw, like, and the game was kind of in the balance then. And they hit a few wides then, and then we went up and we got a point, and Kieran Murphy got a great goal to seal it. Galway, we played them in a few challenge games and stuff, and like, they beat us once and we beat them once, like, and we obviously know they have a good few players from last year that won the All-Ireland, and like, they're going for 3 in a row this year in minor, like, and obviously their seniors being there will give them a boost as well, like, and the footballers being involved. So I suppose, like, they have the advantage, right, and they will be favourites, like, but hopefully we'll give it a good shot anyway.
They say cock-holding is down at the moment. Cock-holding will never be down. It might lapse for a bit, but there's great potential in this team. I'd like to see him playing 3 in a row, and I, please God, he might do what the boys in the 40s done. They might make 4 in a row. So we're always optimistic in Cork that we will do 4 in a row. in this century.
An ugly All-Ireland semi-final was a watershed for both counties, and Tony Keady went from the heart of Galway's defence into the eye of a storm.
I suppose the abiding memory for everybody in 89 was the Tony Keady affair. There was a bit of a saga emerged with Tip and Galway. There was a, after 88 and even the early part of 89, we met in the league final of 89, which was a rip-roaring game in Croke Park. I think Galway won by 2 points the same day. And I suppose the teams were meeting so frequently in big matches at the time that a kind of a bad feeling emerged.
In 89, I went to America and was hurling over there, and I didn't realise, I'd say in 89, that I was doing anything wrong. And I remember Sir Farrell ringing me in America that I had to come home for the hearing, as the man says. And, the hearing was anyway that I wasn't going to be allowed to play in the All-Ireland final, which I thought was ridiculous, like, you know, because I was really only in America promoting hurling, like, you know. And when they did suspend me, like, you know, they lifted the band in on everybody, and they were going back to America the following week, a week after that, in droves, like, you know, so it really wasn't fair.
It's a red, they are gone, Brian O'Mara and Liam Dunn.
Well, it stays popping up again, like, you know, and it's only when someone else happens to, like, in Brian's situation now, like, you know, that I come to light again, like. But, I mean, for the media and that time, like, you know, I just stayed away from them. They just wrote what they wanted to write themselves, like, you know. But, I mean, it was every paper that was printed every day, like, you know, there was something on it about it.
Every one of us wanted Tony Keady to play. Every Tip player wanted Tony Keady to play, I'm certain of that. And it's an unfortunate incident that could have been could and should have been avoided.
This is English out around the half forward line, getting a lot of more space and leeway.
Tip were sickened that Tony Keady couldn't play. We wanted to beat Galway, win in All Ireland, and beating Galway, they were the power at the time, and it had to give us credibility. So, I mean, being competitive and being sporting, you want to beat them at their best, and Tony Keady was without question the best centre back, if not player, in the country.
Let's see, can Tip counter with Nicky English?
I was in the dugout watching the match that day, like, you know, and it's no place to be, like, you know, especially when you know you should have been playing, like, you know, same situation with Brian, like, you know, he it mightn't sink in as much now until the throw-in, but I mean it's nerve-wracking to be just sitting in the line when you know you should be out there, like.
Tracy doing well, unstoppable at centre half back.
And myself and Sean spoke on the day and everything, like, you know, Sean was a good strong man and well able to hurl, like, you know, and I probably wouldn't have hurled it half as well as Sean Tracy on the day, like, you know, so it just goes to show you maybe we did get beaten by a better team on the day.
He was absolutely outstanding on the day itself. Keady would not have been much better, but as I say, I can remember the very peculiar atmosphere in Croke Park that day, very peculiar, and even after the game, we were in an All-Ireland final, but there was no excitement, it was hollow, it was anticlimactic, I don't know what it was, it just overshadowed the whole day.
In 89, I lost interest in hurling completely after 89, like, you know, because what I was done was totally injustice, like, you know. And my career finished when I was 27 years of age. They lifted the ban after that on people going wherever they wanted, like, you know. And there was no lesson, only they taught me a lesson. They just made a scapegoat of me that time, and that's what happened, like, you know. So we lost our 3 in a row.
It could have been Pat Fox or Nicky or somebody that said after the 91 final that they felt they won 2 medals on the one day. It really galvanised the 89 medal, and also having beat Kilkenny, kind of a respected power in hurling in and all Ireland. That, as I say, I thought it was a fitting comment that we did win 2 All-Irelands in 91.
It's definitely history for me at the moment now, definitely. Just that you will still meet that person that will always bring it up, like, you know. And they're always because the Keady affair, like, you know, whether this affair will ever drop or not, I don't know, like, you know. I thought it was gone again, now he led's turned up.
Getting back his place in Tipperary's lineup has been an upward climb for Eugene O'Neill. Now for the final act of the drama.
If I was to pick his position, if I had a choice in the team, I'd be picking full forward. I wouldn't be a big, tall man like a lot of full forwards, but I think the sprint is definitely a good asset to me. I suppose work-wise, I suppose the work I do is fairly physical work, I suppose, in a sense to me. I suppose the best years for me, I suppose, is probably winning the minor in 96, probably a great year. A lot of good memories, making an awful lot of friends in the team.
Eugene O'Neill unmarked momentarily. The youngster just out of the minor grade, Brian Lowe.
I think that was a big step up. I think I was lucky to come into the scene straight away after the minor. In 97, I played again Down and Wexford and Clare one year. And I think it was a great boost to me in 97 to play in an All-Ireland final. And I was knocking Brian Lowe on the same day, probably one of the best fullbacks in the country. And it was a great boost to me to be making the likes of him in my first year and playing senior hurling. I don't think there's much of a difference this year. I think I suppose our trainers and like I said, Nicky and Ken Hogan and Jack, they've been there now a few years, and I suppose they've learned from their experience over the last couple of years, and that would probably be a difference that helped us, all right.
It leaves a lot of space, however. Will it be exploited here? Eugene O'Neill comes on and strikes it over the bar.
I think it's hard on any player to be starting as a sub, but Nick English is always telling us that it's a 20-man game. That there'd be five subs used, and in every game so far, there's four or five subs being used.
Owen Kelly picking it up for tip.
I think the first goal I got, Owen Kelly gave me a brilliant pass. Wait in a slippy ball, it was just a brilliant pass, and Damien Fitzhenry was coming at me, and I tipped it into the corner, and I was delighted to get it. The second one, Eddie Inouye was coming through, and him passed to me. I just saw an opening of a shot, and I just had a look, and hit the ball and went into the bottom corner of the net, and I was delighted after coming on to get those chances, and it's not often you get two goal chances in a half an hour hurling. I suppose it'll give us a couple of us a better chance of getting on now that Brian is gone, but I think everyone in the team would rather if he was there, and that if we were making the team on merit and how we played so fair. I'm delighted to be back. It's a great boost for me to be back, especially come on the last day and score two goals. I think a lot of hurling is about confidence and having your confidence open. I think mine was gone there for a long time. In 99, not making play no county game. And I think last year when I came back in the team, we wouldn't win anything. I think this year is probably, so far, it started bad for me, but I think last day made up for all the games I've been starting so far.
Tipperary have been building towards this point gradually over the past three seasons, ever since Nicky English took over. And you can see the way this season they've developed the knack of winning close games. Galway, on the other hand, literally sprung from nowhere in their semi-final against Kilkenny.
Who's going to win the All-Ireland final between Galway and Tip?
It's a big one.
Tip lads have great spirit, great heart. I've known most of them now for 3 or 4 years. I've watched their careers develop, and they're ready for this one, you know.
With so many duels around the pitch on Sunday, looking like they're going to cancel each other out, you've got to look for big game match winners. And I think in Joe Rabbit and Eugene Clune and Galway have a distinct advantage there.
It's a big one.
I don't know nothing about it, but I heard some of the lads saying Tipperary, so Tipperary definitely.
There are two major issues here for Galway to resolve, in my view. Bookies favourites 5-4 on, they hate that. Since they made the breakthrough in 1980, they've never really managed to put two big performances back to back. Tipperary, I'd be worried about their dependence on young Owen Kelly for scores. 23 points he's got in this campaign. The second highest man, only 9, Mark O'Leary, and then Eugene O'Neill, 2-2.
I think they're going to do the double. And I've got to say that because Mick Bain will absolutely kill me if I say anyone else.
It'll be some final. Brilliant.
This has easily been the hardest All-Ireland final I've ever had to try and call. But having said that, I think that Galway have only given us a glimpse of what they're really capable of, and I expect them to start an era of dominance on Sunday.
It's a big one.
There has to be a small question mark over whether Galway can reproduce the same intensity. But if they do, I believe they will prove themselves to be the best team in the country.
Do you want that I can never travel to Galway or Tip again, yeah?
Next week on...
He gets it in towards Carr. Here's a goal chance. Brilliantly stopped.